Hello and good time of day to you. Requests for advice on replacing the electrolytic capacitors in ZX Spectrum computers are very common in the hardware section of the World of Spectrum forums, so here is my guide to this operation. Unlike some people, I don't advocate automatically replacing all the electrolytic capacitors in any piece of electronic equipment that is more than a few years old. However, I recommend doing this to ZX Spectrums, especially the 16 or 48K models. Failures caused by degraded capacitors are common in these, and in some cases results in permanent damage to some or all of the lower RAM ICs. The electrolytic capacitors are these relatively large cylindrical devices. There are approximately a dozen of them in the 48K spectrum. They tend to fail before most other components because they contain a liquid electrolyte, hence their name. This is necessary for their correct operation, and over time it dries out. Not surprisingly, this happens more rapidly if they are exposed to high temperatures, and the spectrum isn't famous for its frigid operation. Sometimes the electrolyte leaks out. If this has happened, urgent action is required. Some electrolytes are corrosive and will eat away the copper tracks on the circuit board, and sometimes the circuit board itself. These capacitors can develop a number of symptoms as they fail. Their capacitance may decrease. Their internal resistance often increases, and sometimes they become a short circuit. Various tests can be made to check their state of health, but since there aren't too many of them, and they aren't very expensive, it's best to replace them. The electrolytic capacitors originally used in the spectrum are axial-leaded devices, like this one. Their leads emerge from either end. This type is still available, but radial-leaded versions, like this one, are far more common. So this is the type I'll use. Installing them takes a little more effort than is required for the axial variety, but it isn't very difficult. Let's have a look at the markings on these capacitors. The axial one has a capacitance of 4.7 microfarads and a maximum operating voltage of 63 volts. There is an arrow to indicate which lead is its positive terminal. Sometimes the arrow points towards the negative lead instead. The symbols or words on or adjacent to it must be checked to determine which. Axial-leaded capacitors commonly have an indentation around them near to their positive terminal. The radial-leaded capacitor is marked with a value of 100 microfarads and a maximum operating voltage of 25 volts. It has a stripe to indicate which of the leads is its negative terminal. Also, the negative lead is shorter than the positive one. Sometimes this is the only indication of which is which. If you have any doubt about which terminal is the negative one and which is the positive, you must refer to the manufacturer's datasheet for the particular capacitor you have. Electrolytic capacitors are polarized devices and must be connected the correct way around in a circuit. If they are not, they will be damaged, and in some cases even explode, firing fragments of metal and hot electrolyte across the room. Here are the types of electrolytic capacitor used in the 48K ZX Spectrum. The number of each depends on which issue of spectrum you have and which version of the voltage converter circuit it has. All 48K spectrums have two 100 microfarad capacitors, near the front of the board in the middle. These values are very common ones, and you should find it easy to obtain matching replacements. It's perfectly acceptable to use replacements with higher maximum voltage ratings than the ones already installed. In fact, this is a good thing to do, as capacitors with higher voltage ratings generally have a longer lifespan when operated below that maximum voltage. However, don't get too carried away. A higher voltage rating also means larger dimensions, and there isn't much space inside the spectrum. Make sure your replacements aren't too large. Improvements in capacitor technology mean that for the same voltage rating, capacitors are smaller than they used to be. If you buy replacements that are about the same size as the originals, they will probably have higher voltage ratings. You should not use replacements with lower voltage ratings than originally installed by Sinclair. There are some other markings on these capacitors. One says minus 40 to plus 85 degrees centigrade, and the other 105 degrees. To know exactly what these parameters mean, it will be necessary to refer to the manufacturer's datasheet. There will be a statement along the lines of, say, 2000 or 4000 hours at 85 degrees or 105 degrees, whichever is the higher temperature marked on the capacitor. This is the expected operating lifetime of the capacitor at the given temperature. This doesn't seem like very long for a component in a device that may be used daily, but the lifetime is much, much longer if the capacitor's temperature is kept below the stated maximum. A comprehensive datasheet will include graphs or instructions for calculating the expected lifetime under a range of conditions. Most of this isn't very relevant to buying new capacitors for a Spectrum, but if you want to be sure it'll keep on working for at least another 30 years, you might want to choose ones with a maximum temperature rating of 105 degrees rather than 85. Everything else being equal, they should last for longer. However, there will probably be greater differences in lifetime between different brands than between the two temperature ratings. I begin by locating the leads of all the capacitors to be replaced on the rear of the board and straightening any that are bent over. Don't force any that are soldered down. Most of the capacitors on this board have not had their leads bent on the rear. Choose a capacitor to remove and make a note of which end is its positive or negative terminal. If it looks like an original, then it's very likely installed the correct way around, but do not trust this for any that appear to have been replaced by someone else. In most cases, a small plus symbol is printed on the circuit board near to the positive terminal of each capacitor. I've never known these to be incorrect, other than in one position on the issue 2 spectrum. Make sure the soldering iron's tip is clean and has a small amount of solder applied. Heat one lead right where it enters the circuit board pad. Wait until the solder around it is molten and gently pull the lead out. If you force the lead before the solder has melted all the way through to the other side of the board, you may rip the pad and any connecting traces away from the surface. However, don't heat it for too long, as this too could cause pads and tracks to lift away. With the capacitor removed, use the solder sucker to clear away any remaining solder from the holes where the old one was fitted. Examine the board carefully to make sure you haven't done any damage and haven't left any stray blobs of solder. If the board is a bit grimy, you could clean it using a little alcohol. This step is vital if the old capacitor has leaked. You must remove all trace of its electrolyte. This is how I install radial leaded capacitors. Bend the positive lead, the longer one, over. Grip it with a pair of pliers so the lead isn't bent right at the point where it enters the body of the capacitor. Slide a short piece of insulating sleeve over the lead and bend up the end at 90 degrees. Hold the capacitor over where it is to be installed to judge where to bend the other lead. Insert the new capacitor, taking care to make sure it is the correct way around and that you're about to connect it to exactly the same points as the old one. Holding it in place, turn the board over, grip the positive lead, the one with the sleeve over it, and pulling on it firmly, bend it to one side so it'll stay in place. Bend the other lead too, but don't pull on it much. The new capacitor can now be soldered in place and the leads trimmed flush to the joints. If you want to be extra neat and tidy, clean away the flux residue left by your soldering. This is how it should look. Make sure the leads aren't contacting anything they shouldn't. Occasionally, the plastic film over the outside of a capacitor degrades with time and exposes the metal can underneath. With this method of mounting, the insulating sleeve under the capacitor makes sure the can can't short out any tracks that run beneath it. There are one or two capacitors, like this one, where one lead is soldered to a large copper surface on one side of the board or the other. These might be easier to remove if the solder around the joint is first melted and removed from the rear. If you're using a temperature adjustable soldering iron, increasing the temperature a little will help too. If your spectrum is an issue too, then special attention is required in this area. A Sinclair recommended and very sensible modification may or may not have already been made to your spectrum. This change to the voltage converter circuit slows the action of the voltage sensing feedback and slightly increases the chances of this circuit surviving incidents like a peripheral being connected to the edge connector while the power is switched on. If resistor R60, this one, is a 100 ohm resistor, or any value other than 270 ohms, then it should be replaced with a 270 ohm resistor. A 270 ohm resistor normally has red, violet, and brown colored stripes on it. An additional 4.7 microfarad capacitor should then be connected between the base and emitter of transistor TR5. A convenient place to connect this is between the positive terminal of capacitor C34 and the lead of resistor R58 that is nearest to it. The positive terminal of this new capacitor must be the one that connects to C34. This isn't too difficult to achieve if a new capacitor C34 is installed using the same method, but the insulating sleeve slid over its negative lead instead and this one bent back beneath it. The positive lead is then available to connect the additional capacitor to. With a bit of careful wire origami, this can be situated neatly above the resistors. In every issue 2 spectrum I've seen, the circuit board marking of the positive terminal of capacitor C46 is incorrect. This capacitor's negative lead should be connected to the pad near to the plus symbol. If you are ever in doubt about which way around a capacitor should be installed, you must refer to the circuit diagram for the issue of spectrum you have and use a continuity tester to verify what each lead of the capacitor is connected to so you can work out its correct orientation. Some issue 3 and issue 4 spectrums have electrolytic capacitors apparently installed in locations where they don't belong, and one appears to be missing. This is normally how they were assembled at the factory. This was done to implement a new and more reliable version of the voltage converter circuit on circuit boards of an older design. Pay careful attention to where the capacitors are connected and replace them as neatly as possible. Use insulating sleeve over component leads wherever necessary to prevent them from contacting things they shouldn't. Once all the capacitors have been replaced, inspect the board very carefully on both sides for any damage or unwanted solder bridges. I recommend carrying out some basic tests as described in the first half of the video about initial tests to carry out on a spectrum to make sure there are no short circuits across any of the power supply lines before you switch it on. There is also an electrolytic capacitor inside the spectrum's power supply unit. It is far less common for this to fail, and I do not normally replace it if there is no indication of it causing a problem. I do replace it in the power supplies I sell along with refurbished spectrums, just for the added peace of mind.